Let's get started with Apple Motion, but first, what is Apple Motion? Motion's an animation program for creating effects that can be used as plugins for Final Cut Pro. But please don't be intimidated by the interface. You don't have to be a coding expert or a full-time animator to get real benefits from Motion. Just keep it simple and take it one step at a time. My name's Bruce, and if we've met before, welcome back. Otherwise, please like and subscribe and press the bell so I can make more videos like this for you. In this series of tutorials, I'll concentrate on the synergy between Final Cut Pro and Motion. This tutorial is focusing on your first visit to Motion, using the settings to start a new Motion project, and learning where things are. I'll just create a simple title and use some basic behaviors to animate the words in the title. Along the way, you'll learn about the interface and some of the ways to work in Motion. But let me explain, this is not a program you'll just pick up. The more you practice Motion, the more familiar you will be with its features. Launch Motion and select the new project browser. In the left-hand sidebar are all the non-Apple plugins that you've already installed for Final Cut Pro. You can modify any of these in Motion. To see how to modify a plugin in Motion, check out the tutorial Final Cut Pro to Motion and Back. Click the eye above. Now select Blank. Motion Project allows you to start a new project to use independently. The other four options are for use in Final Cut Pro as plugins, that's titles, generators, transitions and effects. I'll select a Final Cut Pro title. It can be converted later to other options under the File menu. In the right-hand panel, select a preset. If in doubt, select Broadcast 720, 1080 or 4K. The frame rate is either NTSC for the USA, or for PAL countries, that's most of the rest of the world, you'll use non-NTSC frame rates. If in doubt, for PAL countries, stick with 25 frames per second. For the USA, 29.97 NTSC. You can set your duration here. I've just put in 4 seconds. Click Open. The interface is made up of four different panels. The top left panel can be populated with the library or the inspector. The library shows all the assets included with Motion. Music and photos access your iTunes on your computer or your Photos app. I suggest you take some time and explore what's in the library. The inspector can be likened to the inspector in Final Cut Pro and has several tabs above that change to suit whatever part of a project you're working in at that time. I'll add some content from the library so you can see how the other panels are used. I'll add Light Streak from the Shape Styles category and by dragging it into the timeline at the bottom right panel. As the playhead's moved, the light streak is viewed at the top right. That's the Project Viewer panel. By default, the playhead will be at the beginning of the project, but be aware that when you add an item, it will be added at whatever position the playhead is in the timeline. If I add another item now, you'll see it's added where the playhead is. I'll move that item to the beginning of the timeline. I'll delete that item. If you want to import your own assets, that's photos, videos, or illustrations, use the Import button at the top of the screen. The light streak can be moved and adjusted in the viewer just like you would in Final Cut Pro. Sized and returned to fit in window as in Final Cut Pro. The items can be enabled and disabled with the ticks in the sidebar. And when selected in the timeline sidebar, it's also selected in the project sidebar above. You'll see that when light streak was added, a group was also created to which light streak was added to. Groups allow for all items within the group to be influenced at once. One of the hallmarks of motion is the way that it animates objects. If you're familiar with Final Cut Pro's keyframes, you'll know that you can animate an object by selecting a point in time and making a change, then adding a keyframe, and then selecting another point in time, changing the animation, and a keyframe is automatically added for you, and so on and so on. Motion takes a different approach and applies the animation's effects you're trying to make as a behavior, which allows for all those multiple changes to be made in one action. Not surprisingly, motion calls these behaviors. You simply add behaviors to assets. They're found at the top of the interface. As with the library, I suggest you spend a bit of time looking at the choices in behaviors. To keep it simple, basic motion, that's fade in, to the light streak. Turn it off and on so you can see the differences. Further adjustments are made in the inspector. Change fade in time for a longer fade and start offset to start the fade later. I'll now add another behavior so you can see how an animation can be adjusted. Add shrink and grow and now play it. There's no visible changes, but now as I move the playhead further down the timeline and change the scale in the inspector, now playing that, the light streak size changes over time without any need for keyframes. You can still work with keyframes if you wish, but they're much more powerful in motion than in Final Cut Pro, and that's mainly because of the ease in and ease out functionality. Select the light streak, set the playhead at the beginning, and select properties in the inspector, and to the right of opacity, click the diamond with the plus inside. Move the playhead down the timeline. Drag the opacity slider to zero. Move the playhead further down the timeline. Move the opacity slider back to 100%. Each time you made a change, a new keyframe was added automatically. And play, and you can see the image fade out and then fade back. To see the actual keyframes, click the keyframe reveal at the top right of the timeline. You can click on the keyframe dots to move them, and right clicking will show the ease in and ease out. Option click on the keyframe line and you can add a new keyframe. You can also make changes in the viewer with a similar logic as you'd be used to when keyframing. Make sure the playhead's at the beginning of the timeline. Turn on the recorder button at the top left of the timeline. Move the playhead forward and adjust the image in the viewer. Move the playhead even further forward and adjust the image again. Turn off the recorder. Now play the timeline. You'll see the red path in the viewer and you can adjust the points. You can right click and change from linear to smooth. In the timeline, the light streak is blue. Its filters are purple. If you move the blue portion, all of the filters below follow as a group, and the effect, including its filters, starts at a certain point in the timeline. If you move the effect and its filters, you'll also see the effect move in the mini timeline above. If you move a filter, it moves independently and also shows in the mini timeline. As the object moves in the timeline, that is the time that it's going to be visible from the beginning to the end. So you could shorten the whole group by just shortening the object, and the filters and behaviors follow suit. And it's now only that time that that object is viewable in the viewer. And of course it can be changed in position. It could also be made longer as well. And if you change the filters or behaviors, then those behaviors only show for the time that they're visible. I'll add a shape to the timeline. Select new group. A new group's been added at the top level of the timeline. Click the Shape button. Select a rectangle and draw a shape in the viewer. The shape's added to the new group in the timeline at the position of the playhead. You can drag it to the beginning. And incidentally, it's not necessary that you created that new group. The shape could have been added to any group, but I selected a new group in this case, and you'll see later why. The new group is now above the light streak, which is now hidden. Select the light streak group and drag it to the top level of the timeline. The light streak's no longer hidden. Now let's add some text. Select the rectangle group in the sidebar. Of course, you could add a new group if you wanted to. Move the playhead to the beginning of the project. Select the T button at the top of the timeline. Draw a rectangle in the viewer and type hello. Select the text tab in the inspector and then the format tab. Fonts and other text formats can be changed here. You can change the size as well as the words. So let's add for now. Click the Appearance tab to change the colours. Now back to the timeline and you'll see the pointer button at the top. This will allow you to move objects in the viewer. Reshape the white rectangle to suit the words and reposition the light streak to suit. Text can also be animated with behaviours. Select the text in the sidebar. Select Arrange In from the Text Basic category. Now play that. Now add another behaviour with the text selected in the sidebar. Text Continuous, Cookie. Now play that. I'll now add a background that can be used as a drop zone. Add a new group. Select the Add Object button and select Drop Zone. Once it's in the sidebar, make sure the group containing the drop zone is at the bottom level of the sidebar. This will allow you in Final Cut Pro to be able to select any image and add it to the drop zone. If you want a default image as a background, but still able to be used as a drop zone, then you need to add that to this drop zone now. Select Photos and drag the photo into the drop zone. Select the drop zone and in the inspector select the Image tab and make sure Drop Zone is selected. Select the group with the rectangle and the text in it, and both will move because they're moving as a group, as I pointed out before. And of course, you may want to remove the background when you get to Final Cut Pro. So select Drop Zone in the sidebar. Select the Properties tab in the inspector. To the right of the opacity, click the downward chevron and publish. And this will allow you to hide the background when you're in Final Cut Pro. Finally, to view what will be seen when you're using the Final Cut Pro Inspector, select Project at the top of the sidebar and Project in the Inspector. You'll see the Opacity option. It can be repositioned so it's seen at the top by dragging it above the source media, and we'll change the name to Hide Background. The project can be exported as a standalone movie by selecting Share. It can be saved as a Final Cut Pro title by selecting Save As from the File menu. Type Sample Title in the Template field. In the category, Add to Build In Out. Now let's look at the title in Final Cut Pro. Drag it into the timeline. Select the T tab in the inspector. The background can be hidden, or you could populate the drop zone with any image. Select the Text tab and select the text. It can be changed and the color changed. But you can't change the color or the position of the white rectangle. This is a classic example of something you'll get used to when you're using Motion. It's because it's such a complex application, there's always going to be times when you've forgotten to adjust something when you're setting it up in Motion. In this case, I should have published the parameters to allow the rectangle to be changed. So let's go back to Motion. Select the rectangle in the sidebar. Select Properties in the inspector and publish the items you want to be able to change in Firebook Cut Pro. So let's do Position, Scale and Opacity. And it'd also be good to be able to modify the color. Select the Shape tab, publish Fill Color and Feather. Now select Project at the top of the sidebar and change Position to Position Rectangle and change Opacity to Hide Rectangle. You can now just simply save this or Command plus S and it'll replace the contents of the previously saved title. Back in Final Cut Pro, the title that was in the timeline will be unchanged. Drag in a new copy of the title and the changes that you made in Motion have been added. Change the position, the scale, hide, and change the color. As you see, Motion's a great support tool for Final Cut Pro, and you've covered a lot of ground in this Get Started tutorial. I'd suggest that you practice this and then do the exercise again to let it sink in. I hope you enjoyed this tutorial. Please like, subscribe, and press the bell so I can make further video tutorials for you.